This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
Yemeni authorities held what they called outlawed saboteurs responsible for the Abyan events. 16 people were killed in clashes between security forces and armed individuals in Abyan city in South Yemen.
دعوات إلى الانفصال ومظاهرات وقتل في حضرموت والضالع ولحج.
Calls for secession, demonstrations, and killings can be found in Hadramaut, Al Dalia, and Lahaji. 16 people were killed and dozens of others were injured in Zinjibar, the capital of Abyan, in armed clashes between security forces and supporters of the so-called political mobilization forces in the south. Clashes took place after security forces tried to disperse the protesters in a festival that was called for by the southern leader, Tariq al-Fadli. Local media sources said that the security forces have attacked the home of Fadli with rocket-propelled grenades. Armed fighters from the southern mobilization forces managed to take control of some security units. Thousands of people have held a demonstration in Zinjibar demanding the release of detainees who were arrested on July 7th. The tense situation explains the growing calls for secession, which were first made 3 months ago when workers demanded better living conditions, an end to marginalization and discrimination against the south. Southerners also believe that their resources are being taken by the north. أهمها تأمين ظروف معيشية أفضل وانتشال أهالي الجنوب من التهميش. Those who support secession accuse the government of ignoring their reservations. The government called the southern mobilization forces to enter into a dialogue and warned that attempts to undermine Yemen's unity would lead to the creation of small states. Meanwhile, those who support the secession want their conditions to be met, which explains why the crisis has not been resolved. إلى دويلات، لكن دعاة الانفصال أرادوها بشروط. As calls for secession continue, Al-Qaeda is waiting for an opportunity to strike. Last March, two attacks were carried out against two Korean tourists and other Koreans in Hadramaut as they were on the road to Sana'a. Meanwhile, the Houthi supporters in Sada continue to launch hit-and-run guerrilla tactics against government forces.
ويخوض اليمن معركة سياسية أخرى في العاصمة.
Yemen is also involved in a political battle between the ruling party and the opposition. Although the parliamentary elections were postponed until reforms are introduced to the constitution, the two sides have not yet entered into dialogue.
على طاولة حوار. وكان اليمن أنهى حربا أهلية انفصالية دامت 70 يوما.
It's worth mentioning that Yemen previously ended a 70-day civil war in which the Socialist Party, led by Ali Salem al-Bed, was defeated in 1994. There was also another fierce civil war in May of 1990, which led to the unity of Yemen.
In their eyes, Lebanon is a piece of heaven. It is their homeland and they want to live in it. They have a message to Lebanese officials, which they express in the following report.
شباب لبنان المغترب الذين في عيونهم لبنانهم مختلف.
These are young Lebanese expatriates. They see Lebanon differently from the way we do. To them, Lebanon is still a place where they can breathe fresh air, and this gives a great feeling of optimism. They know Lebanon from stories they were told by their parents and grandparents, and they came here to see what Lebanon is.
ليقولوا هذا هو لبنان. شباب لبنان المغترب وفي إطار جولته على لبنان زار عاصمة
Lebanese youth visited the city of Sidon in the south. They walked in it and visited the castle. They reiterated their sense of belonging. The youth camp of Lebanese expatriates has strengthened the sense of belonging among these visitors. It planted in them the love for their homeland and love for one another. This is what they had to say in the Khan al Frenj area.
كما قالوا خلال وقفتهم في خان الفرنج.
I look at the Lebanese flag. It is written there that Lebanon is for all of us. I've seen things that I've never seen before. I have seen things for the first time in my life. I also met other Lebanese people that were living in Saudi Arabia on the same street. I met them here in the youth camp. It is a really wonderful feeling.
Where are you from?
From Australia.
No, what is your heritage?
From Sgerta.
From Beirut.
From Ehden.
They left Sidon to Beit al-Din, where they sat across from cider trees and sang the national anthem in their own way.
سهلنا والجبل منبت للرجال قولنا والعمل في سبيل الكمال كلنا
وكزدروا في أرجائها
They walked around and talked about politics the way they understand it. Do you know what the March 14th Alliance is?
أكيد.
Of course.
Very aim.
They support America and Iran.
They are all the same.
Prefer to come without your parents?
Yeah.
Why?
They're annoying.
وفي الختام من شباب لبنان المغترب
The expatriate youth had these messages for Lebanese politicians.
أهم شيء إنه
The most important thing is that politicians agree among themselves.
السياسيين يتفقوا
أنا برأيي إنه الدولة أو السياسيين
We the expatriate youth need to feel safe in Lebanon.
بحاجة للأمان بلبنان
If I can find a job here in Lebanon, I will stay. Of course I will stay here because life in Lebanon is very delicious. I will stay if I can.
And I love Lebanon. And لو الدولة it's يضلوا المشاكل ببعض وما بعرف شو حابب انه كل الحكومة يحبوا بعض وما بقى
I want the Lebanese officials to love one another. I want to feel safe so I can come back. Just like my friend here, I also love Lebanon. Of course I want to come back and marry a woman from the village.
I honestly think that if the Lebanese unite in their efforts, they can make Lebanon the best country in the world.
اتهمت الولايات المتحدة حزب الله بخرق الحظر على السلاح الذي تفرضه الأمم المتحدة.
The United States accused Hezbollah of violating the ban on weapons that the UN implemented in southern Lebanon and of undermining the efforts of the international peacekeeping delegation. Alejandro Wolf, the acting U.S. ambassador to the UN, said that what he described as keeping secret weapons south of the Litani River is a clear violation of Resolution 1701. Wolf added that all indications confirmed that the bombing last week was done by the weapons that Hezbollah has kept. An Israeli ambassador to the UN had sent a letter before to the UN Security Council that contained the same accusations. It is worth mentioning that a conflict broke out between the residents of Kirbat Sulim village in southern Lebanon and the UNIFIL forces during an investigation at the bombed site.
نبقى في لبنان حيث يواصل سعد الحريري
Meanwhile in Lebanon, the leader of the ruling majority, Saad al-Hariri, who was designated to form a new government, is continuing his consultative talks. It has been a month since he started these talks, but he hasn't yet announced the government. Some think that this failure is due to a big difference in opinion between the majority and the opposition parties and the regional polarization in the area. Al Jazeera correspondent Abbas Nasser reports from Beirut.
ساعات المساء عند كورنيش البحر
This is the evening time by the seashore. With or without a newly formed government, this is what Lebanon is like. A break for playing, a break from work, and a break from politics. This is what one would imagine when they see things here. But the truth is that the Lebanese live and breathe politics. They understand their country very well, therefore they do not pay too much attention to these events. If the government doesn't get formed today, it'll be formed tomorrow, they say. And if it doesn't get formed tomorrow, then so be it. Nothing seems to be strange in Lebanon, considering the entire political system is very strange.
كلها غرابة.
They're taking their time to form a government, consulting with Saudi Arabia, Iran, and Syria. When are they going to make decisions on their own?
I do not think it will work. There are too many obstacles.
It's been a little less than a month since Saad Hariri was designated to form the government. He is the leader of the majority, but in the country of Lebanon, he cannot form a government without the approval from the opposition. The opposition demands to have what it calls real participation in the government, meaning it wants a veto power in important issues concerning Lebanon since they have 30% representation in the government. Hariri thinks that circumstances like this make democracy dysfunctional and undermine the results of elections. This is a complicated matter, but it's not the most difficult problem to solve. The real problem lies outside the borders where regional talks are happening between Saudi Arabia and Syria. Some political observers believe that they have not reached a consensus on the issue that is known as reformulating an Arab position pertaining to the Middle East conflict as the United States pushes the peace process forward.
When conditions became difficult abroad, they said this was a Lebanese affair. Every side told their group to derail obstructions and take difficult conditions. Until now, there have been no serious discussions on forming the government.
Indeed, political groups feel the need to maintain their status quo before they can establish a unified government. One factor has both positive and negative effects, which is the fact that the prime minister does not have a time limit for forming the government. It all depends on who can sustain the position the longest. The way in which the government will be formed depends on the arrangement between foreign forces. If the government is formed with the consensus of all Lebanese parties, it means that the regional forces have also reached a settlement. If it's not formed, then it's no surprise to anyone. In Lebanon, there's a frequent saying, during the Syrian mandate, Lebanese governments were formed in seconds. Some say this to rub it in the faces of those who support the ruling majority. Others say it to show their pity over Lebanon's situation, which goes from one problem to another. The only thing that ever changes is the type of crisis. In the end, the Lebanese people should have reconciliation with their surroundings and maybe the world before they can reconcile among each other. Abbas Nasser, Al Jazeera, Beirut.
This Friday seems calm in Iran. However, there are different developments pertaining to the elections. This time, demonstrations were carried out by conservatives who protested Ahmadinejad's appointment of his son-in-law as a vice president. News reports from Tehran indicate that security forces known as Basiji have organized a demonstration following the Friday prayers to protest the appointment of Esfandiar Rahim Mashai as vice president. According to some internet sources, two ministers have withdrawn from the government meeting that was attended by Vice President Esfandiar Rahim Mashai. Once again, Washington is putting its diplomatic weight in the Middle East to revive the peace process and to move it forward on different tracks.
In our top story, a major corruption scandal involving the American Jewish community in New Jersey was revealed following the FBI arrest of several rabbis accused of laundering money through charities in New Jersey, Brooklyn, and Israel. One suspect has also been accused of trafficking in kidneys. The arrest of over 40 people also involves widespread corruption among elected officials. IBA's Ellie Wogelenter has the story.
If the Jewish community received a black eye in the Bernie Madoff affair, the latest scandal is likely to paint the community with an even blacker brush. The FBI yesterday arrested three New Jersey mayors and several rabbis in a sweeping 10-year federal investigation into political corruption that also uncovered human kidney sales and money laundering from Brooklyn to Israel.
Today, we're here to announce the takedown of a large-scale, dual-tracked investigation. On the public corruption side, the FBI and the IRS have arrested and noticed for arrest 29 individuals, including assemblymen and mayors, underscoring more than ever the pervasive nature of public corruption in this state. On the other side, the FBI and IRS have arrested and summoned 15 members of connected international money laundering rings, including five rabbis and their associates. As outlined in the complaints, these rings, led by clergymen, cloak their extensive criminal activity behind a facade of rectitude.
An undercover witness helped infiltrate the money laundering network of rabbis who operated between Brooklyn, Deal, New Jersey, and Israel. Millions of dollars were laundered through charitable nonprofit entities controlled by rabbis in New York and New Jersey. The undercover agent was able to launder some $3 million through the rabbis' network between June 2007 and July 2009.
On the money laundering side, these complaints paint a disgraceful picture of religious leaders heading money laundering crews, acting as crime bosses. They use purported charities, entities supposedly set up to do good works, as vehicles for laundering millions of dollars in illicit funds. The rings were international in scope.
Police also accused a Brooklyn man, Levi Yitzchak Rosenbaum, of conspiring to broker the sale of human kidneys for transplants. Rosenbaum bought kidneys from Israelis for $10,000 and sold them to recipients for $160,000. The arrests also exposed a corrupt network of public officials who were all too willing to take cash in exchange for favors. The court documents read like a cliché-filled movie script. Clandestine meetings were held in parking lots and diners where money to the tune of $97,000 was stuffed in an Applejack cereal box. Among the 44 people arrested were the mayors of Hoboken, Richfield, and Secaucus, state assemblymen, and a Jersey City deputy mayor.
This case is not about politics. It is certainly not about religion. It is about crime, corruption. It is about arrogance. It is about a shocking betrayal of the public trust.
More than 300 FBI and IRS agents were involved in yesterday's arrests, which capped a probe that initially focused on bank fraud within the Syrian Jewish community in Deal, New Jersey, but took on wider political implications. The implications on the worldwide Jewish community are yet to be determined. Ellie Wogelanter, IBA News.
UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon has welcomed the decision of the International Permanent Court of Arbitration, or PCA, on the final settlement of the Abyei dispute between the Sudanese government and the People's Liberation Movement. The Secretary General commended the intent of the parties to abide by and peacefully implement the PCA decision. Ban Ki-moon's comments came during his speech before the permanent representatives of the UN Security Council. The UN held a session this afternoon to evaluate the progress of peace in regions of conflict around the world.
Political transition and jumpstart economic recovery.
Public services and core government functions support a political transition and jumpstart economic recovery. The decision of the Permanent Court of Arbitration in The Hague on the final settlement of the oil-rich region of Abyei between the Sudanese government and the People's Liberation Movement is a major step forward in the implementation process of the Comprehensive Peace Agreement. In the same context, Turkish political constituents have welcomed the decision of the PCA on the demarcation of the boundaries in the Abyei region. Turkey said the decision will help promote peace and security in Sudan, as well as to help strengthen the Nifasa Comprehensive Peace Agreement signed between the two sides. The Turkish political constituents also praised the positions of the ruling National Conference Party and the People's Movement, which vowed to implement the court's decision.
The Turkish political constituents expressed support for the decision of the International Tribunal in The Hague to redefine the boundaries of the disputed region of Abyei. The Secretary General of the Turkish Grand Unity Party, Mustafa Destici, said that Turkey welcomes any decision that will lead to lasting peace and security in Sudan. Destici further said that the court's decision has brought relief and reassurance to the Turkish public. He said that the decision will help map Sudan's future, a future that is filled with prosperity, peace, development, and national unity.
The decision is reassuring at many levels. It helps put the peace process back on track and move Sudan away from war. Most importantly, both sides took their grievance to the International Court of Justice in The Hague, and this was a civilized decision. The two sides vowed to abide by the court's decision.
Zardar Sawash, deputy head of the Turkish Democratic Party, said that a decision like this shows the level of awareness, responsibility, and commitment of the Sudanese government and people. Zardar stressed the importance of achieving coexistence among the people of Abyei.
We would like to call on all sides in the conflict to implement the court's decision in a way that will help promote peace and security and provide quality of life for all Sudanese, including the people of Abyei.
The Turkish public adopted a similar position and said that the International Court's decision is a great victory of Sudanese willpower.
The time has come for the Sudanese people to forgive and overcome their differences. They must look ahead and direct their attention to the welfare of their country and nation. With this, they will be able to achieve development and increase their nation's wealth, which makes us look forward to visiting this part of the world.
Observers and experts on Sudanese affairs said that the best way to honor and implement the court's decision is for the government of Khartoum and the People's Liberation Movement to exercise their influence and make it happen. The court's decision is a crucial step toward achieving the long-awaited comprehensive peace in Sudan. For a long time, Turkey has supported peace efforts in Sudan, and it has rejected campaigns aimed at undermining its national unity. Today, Turkey reiterated its position by backing the International Court's decision, which aims at extinguishing the flames of war in Sudan.
In another related development, the Secretary General of the Organization of the Islamic Conference, Ekmeleddin İhsan Oğlu, has welcomed the decision of the International Permanent Court of Arbitration in The Hague on the Abyei dispute. İhsan Oğlu praised the Sudanese ruling conference party and the people's movement for their commitment to implement the resolution. The Secretary General said in a statement that he hopes the court's decision will help strengthen peace efforts in the region of Abyei.
Confrontations between Benjamin Netanyahu and Barack Obama over Israeli settlements construction dominate headlines in the Arab world and Israel. Will Obama succeed where other U.S. presidents have failed? And why has this controversy been posing a PR nightmare to the American-Israel Public Affairs Committee? Answers to these questions and more on Link TV's Mosaic Intelligence Report.
The Israeli settlement issue has been dominating the headlines in both Arab and Israeli media. It has also been the single biggest source of friction between the United States and Israel since Benjamin Netanyahu became Israel's prime minister in March. The Israeli Haaretz newspaper reported that the Obama administration has issued a stiff warning to Israel not to build in the area known as E1, which lies between Jerusalem and the West Bank settlement of Ma'ale Adumim. Any change in the status quo in E1 would be extremely damaging, even corrosive, the message said. 4 years ago, after resigning from Sharon's government, Netanyahu criticized him for giving in to American pressure on E1. A sovereign government must build in its eternal capital, he said. Sharon set a precedent that will lead to the division of Jerusalem.
A unified Jerusalem is the capital of the Jewish people and the state of Israel, and our sovereignty over it will not be shaken. This means that the citizens of Jerusalem can buy apartments anywhere in the city. This has been and will continue to be Israel's policy.
Controversy over illegal Israeli settlement activities is not something new. It has been in and out of the limelight ever since Israel occupied the West Bank and East Jerusalem in 1967. In the past, it was an ongoing subject of dispute between the Israeli government and the U.S. administration, most notably under Presidents Jimmy Carter and George Bush Sr. Now it is Barack Obama's turn. Meanwhile, the number of settlers living in the West Bank and East Jerusalem, where Palestinians regard the area as the heart of their future state, is swiftly approaching 500,000. Israel has, in the former Israeli Prime Minister Yitzhak Shamir's words, been successfully creating new facts on the ground. However, the past U.S. policy toward Israel's illegal settlements construction in the occupied territories has been largely non-interventionist, so that demand for a moratorium on settlement building in East Jerusalem by the Obama administration is seen today as hardline. Meanwhile, The recent confrontations between Benjamin Netanyahu and Barack Obama over the settlements issue has been posing a PR nightmare to the American-Israel Public Affairs Committee, APAC, and the Israel Project, the organization spearheading Israel's public relations efforts in the United States, which has recently released its 2009 Global Language Dictionary, authored by Republican pollster Frank Luntz. When discussing Israeli settlements, the author suggests avoiding religious arguments or quoting from the Bible, warning that even your Jewish audiences will recoil. He also added, claiming that the land really belongs to Israel is unconvincing because officially Israel itself defines the territories as disputed. In 2005, I co-produced the documentary Occupied Minds with my Israeli colleague David Michaelis. During our visits and interviews conducted in settlements across the West Bank, we faced the very arguments that the Israel Project is trying to avoid being made by fanatical settlers whose strategy is to make life so miserable for Palestinians living in nearby villages that they will eventually flee, enabling them to occupy their abandoned land. These settlers justify their right to this land as being granted to them by God. Victims of these unchecked settler incursions, the poor villagers live in cramped neighborhoods either menaced by settlers, surrounded by either Israel's separation wall or barbed wires, or all of these. They're not beneficiaries of Israel's ludicrous natural growth argument, although Palestinians' childbirth rate is 3 times greater than that of Israelis. One settlement leader suggested Palestinians move to Jordan. It's a generous offer, he added.
And my suggestion is, and this is a great compromise, that I am giving up on the other side of Jordan.
But you don't have Jordan.
Yes,
but
you don't
have it.
We are giving up because this is originally part of land of Israel.
Now let me be clear. The United States strongly supports the goal of two states, Israel and Palestine, living side by side in peace and security.
Will Obama succeed where other U.S. presidents have failed? Only time will tell. With more settlements and more facts on the ground, the road to a two-state solution has hit a dead end. I'm Jamal Dajani for the Mosaic Intelligence Report. To learn more about this program or to share your thoughts, visit us at linktv.org/mir. To receive my daily updates, follow me on Twitter.
The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.